from what I can gather, your films have been touring festivals as a pair this year because they were shot. How far apart were they shot?
They were actually shot a year apart, but the editing started to overlap. Like, I went into production on Thou Wast Mild and Lovely while I was just finishing the editing of Better on Latch. And as you can imagine, like, when you go into production on a film, everything gets a little haywire. So, and then we were like racing for deadlines for Mild and Lovely. And so it was just like, I would edit Mild and Lovely for like 3 months and then like take a month and be editing Butter and then like 3 months on Mild and Lovely and then like 2 months editing Butter, and then Butter got into its first festival in the US and then premiered in Berlin. It got in early to Berlin, premiered in Berlin, was going to premiere in Berlin like 8 months later, and by the time that the Berlin deadline came, I had finished the other film, and so they ended up coming out together.
Okay. So that's interesting, because I didn't know there was that much overlap between them in terms of production, because one of the things I was going to ask you, and one of the reasons why it's interesting they're traveling together and being seen together, yeah, is because they're very much of a piece stylistically, I think. And so I was wondering, how much transference is there between what you learned on Butter on the Latch and what you developed to what you applied on Thou Wast Mild and Lovely?
A lot, I would say, because Butter on the Latch was an improvised film, and then I was actually originally thinking about improvising Thou Wast Mild and Lovely, but one of the actors was a little resistant, and I love writing, but I think sometimes I avoid it because I can be a bit of a perfectionist, and then maybe never make the movie if I'm just like, okay, well, I'll just keep writing. And it's fun to just let yourself make your art, because nothing's ever perfect. I mean, you can write something into oblivion, and anything that's perfect on the page may not be that great on the screen. So those were like elements like that kind of coming in. But I would also say I grew as an editor and as a storyteller between the two films. Like, I think Thou Wast Mild and Lovely is a bit stronger narratively, although I'm really proud of the bold experimentation that I was doing in Butter on the Latch. So, and it's funny, like, I think I want some of that in the next film I make, but I also want that narrative structure, so hopefully I'll just like bring those two worlds together.
Yeah, because one thing I really like about your films, and I agree that the second one, Thou Wast Mild and Lovely, does feel more plotted, but it's almost as if the plot doesn't exactly matter in them, because there's a rhythmic sense to them. The way that the camera moves is really intuitive, and it's taking you through the story more than any structured beats.
Right.
And I presume that's very conscious, and I presume because I think you have a background in making documentary shorts and things like that, don't you? So does that apply to how you work in that sense? Does a documentarian's eye allow you to be more free in the sense of capturing things and not worrying about keeping to a structure or a script?
I definitely think that having worked in documentary for a long time has freed me up a lot in terms of being a storyteller. Because also, you know, like in documentary, how much you can do in the editing room. I mean, with documentaries, you're just like flying and you're like, I don't know how this turns into a movie. But then in editing, you're like, oh, you can really sculpt a world in the editing room that maybe isn't even apparent to you when you're filming. That said, it's really nice to have a little bit more control than that documentary world when you're just relying on truth. It's nice to be able to be like, let's make truth a little bit more exciting.
Right. Yeah.
But I do feel like a lot of freedom because of that background.
And in terms of the editing as well, because the films are quite short. In fact, as I said, they're very short. Especially Butter on the Latch, I don't know what the official like cutoff point is in terms of screening films for what classifies as a short and a feature, but it feels like it's skirting that line. But it's also a film where I don't feel like anything is missing. It feels very complete.
Right.
But how much did you leave a lot on the cutting room floor? Is it molded in the editing room? How much is actually
in the film?
In the film.
Well, so Butter on the Latch, it's interesting because principal photography, which was really just all shot at that camp, was only 5.5 days. That's how long the camp is. The camp is a week. And so it was very fast. It was like really, really fast. And I thought I was making a short. I did think Butter on Latch would be a short film. And then but I'm coming from a documentary background. I like really shot the shit out of that movie. Like we shot like 8-hour days. My DP was very a little upset at the end of each day. She was like, I'm working alone. It was just three of us on the crew for Butter on Latch. She was like doing everything herself. So I had an original cut of the film just set at that camp, and I kind of kept feeling like, I don't know if it's quite there. And I submitted that to the Maryland Film Festival, but I had been showing it to some editor friends, and some of them had been like, well, I wonder if you could show us the world before she arrives at the camp. And And it seemed like a really good idea, and it might offer us a chance to set up some of the kind of crazy stuff that happens at the end of the film. And so when it got into Maryland Film Festival in the United States, I was like, wait, now I really got to finish the movie. So we actually, like, I found out about Maryland maybe like 4 weeks before, decided that we were going to start shooting. Like, so the next week we started doing shoots. While we were already sound mixing the rest of the film, we started shooting this like opening sequence, and then added like 7 minutes at that point for Maryland. And I think this beginning is, I really feel good about it. I really like the opening of that film.
I love the opening. It's really strange, actually, that you say that, because for me, my reading of the film, mm-hmm. the beginning informs everything.
Right.
Because to me, there's this binary complex going on between the women, and, you know, it opens with this, what looks like a piece of performance
yes.
art, and then she walks out and has the phone call experience,
right.
and then seems to, her experience that we see very briefly seems to echo that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know how much you like talking about what it actually all means, but were you aiming for that sort of binary complex? Because I don't even know that the secondary character exists
right.
in my mind.
That was the goal, was to kind of have that be a question that the audience
yeah.
lives with, like,
right.
was she real or not? Yeah. That was definitely
okay.
a thought process went into that. I mean, I was thinking like, oh, is there a way to kind of do in the first 7 minutes what I'm trying to do in the whole film, just so that it's sort of like The Shining when they sit down at the beginning of the movie and he's like, well, the last guy who worked here went insane and killed his whole family.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's like, you know, from moment one what's going to happen in the film, but then you're just like waiting for it to unfold. I mean, not that I think I'm as smart as Kubrick, but... But I think that sometimes giving the hint of that allows the audience to follow you as you go down these like strange pathways.
Yeah, well, the film opens itself up beyond narrative, and
mm-hmm.
even in the way that it's shot, because you know that opening sequence where she's having the phone call, walking down the street, it would be very even logical or simple to just film her and track down the street,
mm-hmm.
but the camera is moving so frenetically, it's almost
yeah.
as if you're in her headspace.
Right.
And the whole film feels like that. It feels like it's drifting between headspaces, and
mm-hmm.
it's very free. I mean, I wonder if you could talk about your collaboration with Ashley Connor and how you got to know her and what you talked about, because the camera work in these films is extraordinary.
Thanks. Ashley shot all the films that I've made. It's funny too, because I think she's so much restraint as a DP, like, She's able to really take her time, and so like let's say that she's shooting something here, and then action begins on this side of the frame. Instead of being like my documentary background as a DP, I'd be like, boom, you know, like get over there because this is only gonna happen once. But she, knowing that like we're in the middle of a scene and like shooting, she'll just be like slowly arriving, and I find that really enhanced this feeling in the film, which was like something intense is going on and we can't always see it. We're just sort of like touching the edge of the iceberg of that thing. And I feel like Ashley was very much like in tune with that, with her photography. So I love working with her. I really feel like she just went all the way with Butter on the Latch, and I'm really grateful.
Yeah, because I think that Wast, Mild and Lovely seems to take that camera style in Butter on the Latch and really expand it. And I think find a location and a dramatic circumstance where it makes even more sense. So. Obviously, you can see. Well, I presume you conceived them separately as well, because
mm-hmm.
you made Butter on the Latch first. So, did you, having worked with her in a fiction feature context, and started putting that together and seeing how her images look, consciously know how to instruct her style or collaborate more on how you're going to integrate it into that? What's Mild and Lovely?
Well, definitely, I was a lot more active in Mild and Lovely in terms of. Like Butter on the Latch, I really gave her a lot of free rein, partly also because the crew was so small that I had so much else to do just producing wise. So it was really nice to be like, oh, Ashley, pick what you think is best. And usually it was the best. I mean, it's amazing actually working with a DP. I mean, she spends her whole life looking through a camera at scenes and is very intuitive about what's going to like energize the scene visually. And so it's funny because Mild and Lovely, I was a bit more proactive. Like I had more camera ideas and more time to have camera ideas. I had more structure and support on that shoot. But I sometimes regret it because I think it's not quite as wild as Butter on the Latch, and I miss that a little bit, even though we did definitely do some crazy things in That Wast, Mild and Lovely. So.
Well, yeah, it does have some crazy things, but the tone is really unsettling and strange right away, because,
yeah.
I mean, I'm sure you've heard comparisons to Malick before,
mm-hmm.
but it seems almost as if you're... deconstructing Malick or making a parody of him in a way, because there's that opening shot where the father and daughter are playing and it looks very just friendly and natural, and then you realise what they're throwing around.
Right.
And the tone is offset immediately, and the camera is so attuned to what they're doing. Mm. And then, of course, like I sort of have to ask you about the cow POV, just where that comes from. But what was the thought?
I don't know. You know, it's funny because when you're writing, I wrote Mild and Lovely while I was reading this book, The Artist's Way, and you just write 3 pages a day and you don't really think about it. You just like write. And so what comes out is very intuitive, and it's just without all the restrictions and with kind of without thinking. And I feel grateful that I wrote that script that way, because I think if I had been thinking about it, I would have written a much more like structured and normal movie. Mm-hmm. And I'm really interested in that, like when you unleash the unconscious, like what comes out. And I think I'm particularly curious about like dream spaces in films, and like, because I think films are really like, we're just making dreams for lots of people to see. So that moment, the cow POV, it felt really important, like narratively actually, like just that there's this thing that Steinbeck does a lot in his literature, which is like he's focused in on these characters so deeply, and you're really like inside their worlds and their heads, and then you come out, and like Steinbeck will write about the land, and somehow in writing about the land, it's like he's saying more about the characters than you even know through any of their actions or dialogue, and we're so affected by our space. So I think to some degree, when you're inside of a story, if you can like come out of the story a little bit, sometimes it reveals more about the story than it would otherwise. Like I think shifting in this really intense kind of like sex scene in the film to this cow perspective, it just makes it suddenly something else. Like you suddenly see the smallness of things and the banalness maybe of violence.
One of the things I love about That Was Mild and Lovely is the fact that it doesn't settle on one genre or tone.
Yeah.
It's very fluid.
Right.
And writing in such intense sessions where you're maybe not self-evaluating as much, does that inform that? Because your brain
Funny, yeah, because a lot of people are like, what genre is this movie? And I'm like, I don't know, idea. Yeah, it's all of them, hopefully. I mean, that was always my goal, even when I was like, thought I would be making kids movies, like, was to make a film that like really gave you the range of human emotion. Because those are the films I love, that you like, you cry and you laugh and you're terrified. And and I think that is more like life. I mean, moments translate into other moments, you know, like the moments of joy move so quickly into like hatred, and the opposite, like moments of boredom can become discovery or sexuality. So it's just, our lives are always shifting genres, so why not have your films?
No, exactly. And that's one of the reasons why I say it's so intuitive, because it feels its way through that process, I think, rather than plotting it. You mentioned children's films there. Do you have any plans to make a children's film? Because I think that would be so interesting following these.
I would really love to. Oh my God. I wish that those were the scripts that my agents were sending me. They're sending me a lot of horror films, and I'm like, I just made two. I don't think I need to like keep that energy around. Also, it's very cathartic to make a movie, and I think I feel like I got out a lot of my darkness with these two films, and I'm now exploring stuff that's a lot lighter and more fun and more playful, more collaborative. So the next film, I think, will be a comedy. So maybe that's like one step closer to a kid's movie. Yeah.
Hopefully, because I think that would be really interesting. But obviously, you the first film was entirely improvised. The second you wrote. Are you open to directing other people's scripts as well? Because you mentioned there about being sent them.
Yeah, I am. I have been looking at other people's scripts. I mean, right now, I'm getting really invested in the next project that I'm going to be making. And we'll be creating that as a kind of as a devised work with the actors. So the actors will be incorporated in the writing process. So I am like actively like open to other scripts.
Okay. And of course you edited the film as well. Mm-hmm. And so do you see yourself as someone who can change gears quite easily? Would you edit another person's film?
Yeah, I spent a lot of this year editing a short film. Well, it's not that short. It's like 20 minutes for a female filmmaker. And I really love editing. I think it's so fun. It's kind of, I think of filmmaking a lot as like, that's very musical for me, and so that I was never interested in composing, but I was always such a writer, and editing, it's really, I mean, you really are writing the film, but you're also like conducting a musical symphony, the symphony of the movie, Like I feel like there's moments when I like hit it in editing where I'm like, yes, yes, yes. Like I just know that's like the transition is like saying something, this exact thing that the film needs to say then. And I'm just like, duh, 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 you know, like get really, it's like, you feel like a superhero. It's kind of when like, it's all the pieces start to meld. So I would say editing is like, yeah, one of my favorite parts of the process. Editing and casting, actually. I really like casting.
Yeah, because how does the casting work for you? Because obviously you've been in a few of Joe Swanberg's films, so I presume mm-hmm. you had a working relationship with him. But how do you cast? Because also the actors in Thou Wast Mild and Lovely in particular have very distinctive yeah. faces.
Oh, that's good.
Do you
good.
Look for a face or do you look for
I
a particular style?
I usually just pick actors that I'm excited to work with. Like Joe was somebody who I really had him in mind for this part, so I'm really glad that he made himself available to play it. Just like a silent but very strong man. I think Joe is a much stronger person than this character is. But the sort of like adventurous spirit, but that also maybe it's like has that kind of mysterious silence in him. I wanted that to be in this character. And then Robert Longstreet, the father, somebody I'd seen in a movie called Cataclysm, which is so funny. And Robert plays this really beautiful, very complicated, kind of like big brother character. And I just loved him. I loved the nuances in that performance and how he could be so harsh and so soft at the same time. And I felt really strongly that he was the right person for the father. And then we actually held auditions for the lead female. All video like auditions. So people just sent in their like the scene. And Sophie Traub, who ends up playing Sarah, I just remember getting her audition tape and being like, wow, it's like the camera isn't even there. It didn't feel like she was acting, it felt like she was the person. And so, it worked out really well. But I think that's a lot of that is just like, I mean, I think a lot of directing is just like figuring out, like raising your antennas to like who are gonna be people that are interested in making work in the style that you want to make your work. So it was a good collaboration with all those guys.
You said that you prefer like the casting best and the editing best, and I noticed that's the bookending processes.
Right, that's
so
true.
The biggest process, of course, is the directing, where you're managing people and you're telling a story. Mm. Do you find that stressful, or are you...
Well, you know, it's funny you say it's the biggest process. It's the shortest. I mean, the directing is much shorter than either the casting or the editing. I mean, the editing, you're in the editing room for like... I edited my own movie for like a year and a half. I mean, it was... with breaks, but like... Yeah, I'm glad I love editing, because otherwise I think I would hate my life. Definitely the best part of making a movie is being on set. It's so much fun. You feel so alive. You're so challenged every moment. You're making a ton of decisions, and you're really relying on a lot of people to help you. I think it's gorgeous, and I think I'm getting better at directing. Not even necessarily like that. I mean, I think I am actually growing as a director, but I think I'm just getting better at being able to enjoy that process and trust my collaborators more, be more specific and communicative about what I want, and also know how much prep time is needed, like how much I need to communicate ahead of time, because like once you're on set, it just needs to go. Everyone needs to know what movie's being made and how they can contribute. But it's nice. I think I'm growing to be a little bit more demanding, like in a good way, like just keep asking until I feel satisfied that I've gotten what I want. I mean, I think I've always done that anyway, but maybe I was a little more passive about it. Like, I'd be like, sure, we can get it your way, and then we'll get it my way. But that exhausts people too. Like, so it's nice to just be like, I want it like this. And inside of that, there's also a lot of like, you know, how can I like give space for Ashley to like play and for the actors to have time to improvise. And so it's managing a lot of like people's roles and hopefully helping people creatively explore, investigate, and shine. Yeah.
So you mentioned that the editing process for this one, for Thou Wast Mild and Lovely, was a year, mm-hmm. and the previous editing process was longer as well. I wonder how many versions of the film occurred and were scrapped in that time. How many different shapes did it take?
Like 3,000. So many shapes. I mean, at first the film was narrated by Cow and was like kind of a comedy.
By the cow whose point of view we see.
Wow. Yes. That version I really liked. It was very lighthearted and funny, and it was not going to do well. So we made it a lot more ominous. And I kind of switched editors. I mean, part of it was that our first editor, like 6 months had gone by and we were like, but knew that there was more work to do and he needed to move on to another project. And I think yeah, anyway, so it worked out really well that I found David Barker when I did, because he just like made that movie sing, I think.
Yeah, it's I just, like I said, I agree with you as well in terms of, you say you're growing as a director, and with absolutely no disrespect to Butter on the Latch, which I also really like, I feel like this is such a more confident film. Mm. And actually seeing someone grow as an artist so quickly between two projects is really quite amazing, I think.
Yeah.
You've made an analogy earlier to like editing being like a symphony, and you mentioned Steinbeck when we talked about Thou Must Be Wild and Lovely, which usually when directors talk about films, they use explicitly cinematic language and reference points. So I wonder what your background is in the arts, and if you came to film, if that was your first thing, or what else are you involved in?
Besides film,
I wonder if, like, because I know you've obviously have acted in some of Jay's films as well, if that was because you were pursuing acting, or was that a favor? Did you know him at the time?
I was a musician growing up and a dancer, and then acting, I was always pretty bad at it, I thought. But I also really didn't connect to theater that much. I wanted to see more naturalistic performances. I was more interested in like real authenticity rather than like somebody on a stage speaking in a really loud voice, you know, which I was like, that doesn't seem like real life. So music and literature were big influences, were what I kind of studied in college. And then Joe invited me to act in his films because we met on the film circuit. I had a music video playing. I was directing documentaries. And so I'd been on the film festival circuit for a few years when I met him. And he invited me to be in this movie. And I was like, I'm not an actor. Like, I don't know what I'm doing. He's like, you're just going to play yourself. Don't worry about it. Don't think about it. Just show up. And I was like, okay, I can do that. And I think it helped a lot. I mean, his style is very minimal. Like, there's no script. And you really are just playing a version of yourself. And given that I had worked in documentaries for so long, I think it made it a lot easier to just be myself on camera, because a lot of working docs, as you're doing right now, it's like, how do you like pretend like the camera's not there and just have a conversation? Mm-hmm. And you as the interviewer, make the camera invisible for the other person. Like, if you're engaging them and you're not like always like, okay, great, you know, that just needs to like disappear from the room, and mm-hmm. then you get really good stuff out of your interview subjects. And so I was used to being around cameras, and I think it just worked out well. And then I've gotten a lot more acting work since then, which has been great. But it all affects filmmaking. I mean, I feel really lucky to have had the acting experience. It helps me learn a lot about directing, and being on other sets is great. Like, you see what works leadership-wise, and I get to learn a lot of technical things. I've acted in something this summer that had a great camera package, and I was like, oh, I want that, you know? So it's nice to just get to explore other people's worlds. And also, when you're a director who also acts, you know a little bit more, I think, or I certainly learned a lot about what does an actor want from a director, like. Mm-hmm. And usually you want feedback. You want to know, like, this isn't working, and you want real honesty so that you can give the best performance.
So I was going to ask you about your like cinematic reference points as well, but I feel like actually that's a less relevant question, because I feel like filmmakers reveal more about how they make films by their taste rather than what explicitly influenced them. Mm. So I just want to ask about what a few movies that you love, maybe things you saw in that period of being in college and exploring things.
I love, ironically, it's funny. I mean, I really did think I was going to make kids movies. I mean, that's kind of, they were why I wanted to make films. Like, I love the Pixar films. The movie The Last Unicorn, I think it's like one of the best movies ever made. Babe is my favorite movie of all time, Babe the Little Pig movie. So there's like, those were like crazy references.
But interesting, they make sense, because Babe is a farm film.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, wouldn't it be great to have a double bill of Babe and Thou Wast Mild and Lovely? Right. That would be amazing.
Okay, I need to make that happen at some point. That's a brilliant idea. That is such a good idea.
We're going to make
it
happen.
Oh my God. I should totally do that, because my films are getting released in New York, so.
I was going to ask you, this is my next thing about distribution. Mm-hmm. It's hard for independent filmmakers, that's obvious.
Yeah.
But as I said earlier, you've also made films that are quite short. How hard has it been to talk with distributors and get people interested? I mean, I'm sure they like the films, but I'm also sure that length panics people. Would that be right?
Well, you know, Butter on the Latch, for Berlin, I made it longer. I cut a lot of it out, actually, and made it longer, so it's like 72 minutes. But the films, it's kind of nice because you can film them kind of not back to back exactly, but they're short enough that like as a pair it's not overwhelming to see both films, even though maybe emotionally it is, like time wise that's like 2.5 hours altogether. But they're coming out together this fall in New York. They're going to be released at the IFP Media Center in Brooklyn and like on iTunes and Fandor and Amazon.
Okay,
that's really exciting. And they're going to get released here, I think, crossing fingers and, you know, knocking on wood. I don't know if wood. They're going to come out, I think, hopefully do a tour of the UK. So I'm really excited about that. Yeah.
Okay. And so finally, how far along are you into your next project? Because it seems like you work quite fast or as fast as you can. So I just can't wait to see.
I would definitely say that I work as fast as I can. And it feels so slow. I'm hoping to shoot the next project in March. That is kind of right around the corner in a way, because we're still developing. I'm working on this, like I said, where it's a bunch of actors are writing. We're kind of like writing very deeply together. So I'm very curious to see what emerges. But so these guys, I'm hoping that by December, I have a good foundation, and then I can write December and January, and then the aim would be to shoot in March, and it's kind of set in this clown class, but a lot of it will be from perspectives of like the ideas that when is the moment when an actor transcends himself, and when are they kind of stuck inside of the prison of their ideas, and so at moments when an actor really like becomes something else, like the film will also like become that character or creature. So it'll be partly from the perspective of a sea turtle, partly from the perspective of a prison inmate, so it's going to be a fun adventure.
That sounds great, and I can't wait. So best of luck,
thanks.
And thank you for talking with me.
So thank you for having me.